This is the world's largest diverging diamond interchange. It's a fancy new traffic configuration designed to fix traffic, and this one was installed in Sarasota, Florida as a response to insane population growth occurring in the area. With the increase in population came an increase in cars, and with the increase in cars came an increase in traffic. So to deal with it, they decided to build this in hopes that it will fix traffic forever. Except, well, it didn't. And there's a reason why, but it might not be what you think. To be fair, this is actually a really impressive feat of traffic engineering, and it did help improve traffic flow at this location. It might look confusing and dangerous at first glance, but it's actually fairly simple. This interchange design operates on a fascinating and simple concept. Just flip the road. It directs traffic to the opposite side of the road, which improves traffic flow and significantly reduces the potential for crashes. Here's how. As you approach the interchange, the road is split up into two separate one-way streets. Then, each side crisscrosses at an intersection, directing traffic to the opposite side. This temporary flip in traffic flow is the key to its efficiency and safety. Now that the traffic is on the opposite side, there's no longer any interference from oncoming traffic. This means that drivers entering the highway can freely turn left to merge onto the highway without waiting for a green arrow. Or worse, everyone judging for themselves if they have enough of a gap in oncoming traffic to turn, because that just isn't fun. The same principle applies to traffic exiting the highway. If you need to turn left after exiting, you're already on the side of the road going left, making the turn quicker and easier. When you compare it to a traditional interchange, anyone turning left has to wait for both directions to stop before they can turn. This slows everyone down and creates backups. Now, since this particular diverging diamond is huge, the exits are controlled by traffic lights to improve safety and reduce individual decision making, but they technically don't have to be here. Some smaller diverging diamonds, like this one in Iowa, just have yield signs here instead. The only thing that can't change are these two traffic signals here and here, located on the intersections where the road actually flips. These two intersections are actually incredibly simple though. There's only one rule, just go straight. The only way you can really mess up in a diverging diamond is if you're blind or like to ignore road signs, and at that point you probably just shouldn't be driving. Diverging diamonds have signs, painted lines, and even green arrows pointing you exactly in the direction you need to go. Just follow your lane, obey the traffic light, and drive. It might seem confusing, but it's a really simple concept actually, and as a result, ends up being a lot safer. A study of one diverging diamond found that crashes were reduced by 46% after reconfiguring the interchange into a diverging diamond from what was previously a traditional interchange. A significant reason for this is that diverging diamond interchanges have nearly half the conflict points of a traditional interchange. Conflict points are where traffic crosses or turns across the path of another direction of traffic, and can result in a crash. The decrease of conflict points in diverging diamonds is from eliminating some of the most dangerous maneuvers, like left turns across oncoming traffic. At this point, it sounds like an all-around win. Better traffic flow and better safety. How could there be a problem with that? But the problem doesn't necessarily come from the design of the interchange, or even the interchange itself. Instead, it's everything around the interchange. More specifically, this, and this, and this. Let me explain. Surrounding this interchange is a massive shopping center filled with restaurants, stores, malls, and most importantly, tons and tons of parking lots. And as a result, this creates traffic. And during busy times, it puts a strain on the entire road network in the area. Eventually, it creates backups. And eventually, those backups make their way to the diverging diamond. And we really don't want that to happen because while diverging diamonds may have a ton of benefits, as soon as they start to back up, chaos ensues immediately, and people lose their minds. The backups get so bad, people start driving in reverse. Yeah, don't do that. One of the flaws of the diverging diamond is the distance between lights that are operating on the same phase. This is all based on the assumption that traffic from here will make it past here by the time the next light turns green, leaving this entire area clear for traffic from the other directions. But clearly, assumptions don't always play out in reality. On paper, this isn't an issue, because ideally, drivers wouldn't proceed from here unless they knew that they could get to here without backing up traffic. But drivers are human, and humans don't understand that. So they see their light is green, they start driving, they get stuck, and then the next phase starts, but now they're blocking traffic. And if you haven't noticed the other major problem with this yet, let's look at the traffic light situation. Once drivers pass their light here, they have no idea what color their light is, meaning all of these cars here are just stuck in the intersection without knowing when it's safe to go again. So these cars backed up here mean these cars can't go, but then those cars are only backed up because of this intersection, but then this intersection backs up meaning this traffic can't go because the traffic here is backing the intersection. The entire reason this interchange had to be built in the first place was because of traffic. But the traffic is a result of the way we interact with the built environment, specifically how we get around places. To understand what happened here, let's go back 18 years ago. This entire development was nothing more than an empty field. a blank slate to build. And over time, it filled in with what it is today. But it didn't have to be this way. Instead of designing a place with so much of the space dedicated to cars, what if more of it was designed for humans? When places are designed for humans, the scale and layout are tailored to the natural movement of people, rather than vehicles. This approach creates a fundamentally different kind of space. Pedestrian-friendly design allows for walking and biking not to just be an option, but the preferred modes of transportation. These methods of getting around are inherently space efficient. Unlike cars, people on foot or bikes require much less room. Destinations like shops, offices, parks, and residences can all be situated closer together, making them more accessible for everyone and fostering a sense of community. So, how did we get to something like this? Let's say we just created a new city. We've got a few houses and businesses, and people can easily walk or bike between them. Next, we build a road, which introduces cars into our city. But this means we have to make room for all of the cars to park, and places catered to cars like gas stations. Now that things are further away, more people are incentivized to drive between them rather than walk or bike. This leads to demand for wider streets capable of handling more cars and more parking lots for those cars to be parked. Before you know it, you've created a place that is no longer for people, but rather for cars. This car-centric development creates an environment where things have become so far away from each other that using a car becomes not just the norm, but often the only feasible mode of transportation. It disincentivizes other forms of transit, like walking or biking, because of how long it would take to get there, and the safety concerns from traffic. And this is exactly what happened here in Sarasota. This interchange was built to accommodate a high volume of cars, only adding to the car-dominant nature of the area. As a result, the interchange, while efficient for moving cars, becomes part of an environment that prioritizes cars over people, making it difficult and unsafe for those without a vehicle. Or so it seems. But believe it or not, the Florida Department of Transportation actually designed it with bike lanes and pedestrian crosswalks, so it should be accessible and usable for everyone, not just those in cars, right? It's not like their own video of the project has someone parked in the bike lane, but regardless, I wanted to put it to the test. I'm going to see what it's like getting from one end of this interchange to the other as a pedestrian and see how bad it really is. So right now I'm at the first crosswalk before, and I'll admit, this is not the best place to be. It's honestly a little scary. Granted, there's only one lane to cross right here, but this traffic is moving at speeds to enter a highway. So now we're on the sidewalk heading to the next crosswalk, and this one actually has a signal. You just have to hope that all five lanes are actually going to stop. So now we're in the median in the middle of the road between the two sides, and it's definitely not a pleasant place to be, but it is at least protected by these physical walls on both sides. So now I'm at the third crosswalk, but it's a little backed up, so it should make for an interesting crossing as a pedestrian. Now there's just one more high-speed entrance ramp to cross, and I will have crossed the entire interchange. Thankfully, I made it across and didn't die, so that was a plus. I gotta give it some credit. There is at least a way to navigate this interchange as a pedestrian. A lot of highway interchanges don't have any way to cross unless you're in a car. I honestly don't think there really is an ideal way to cross a highway interchange as a pedestrian, mainly because it wasn't made for them. But does this mean the Diverging Diamond is our best solution then? Well, it depends on what problem we're trying to solve. Between the signage, the speed of the cars, and the sheer size of this infrastructure, this space was clearly not designed with pedestrians in mind. And at this point you might be thinking, just get in a car and stop complaining. But the thing is, while this specific interchange may have improved safety and traffic flow at this one particular point, that doesn't change the fact that everything around it is still filled with traffic, cars, and parking lots. For example, the very next intersection is at the brim with capacity despite having 26 lanes. If an intersection this large is still not big enough to handle the capacity, how big are we willing to build? At what point is an intersection too large? The more we grow these spaces for our cars, the less we actually want to be in these places, regardless of if we're in a car or not. Even in a car, being here is not a good experience. You spend so much of your time searching for parking and waiting at traffic lights. The root of the problem isn't the road, it's the way that people here have no other option but to drive here. For too long, urban planning has been car-centric, leading to sprawling landscapes dominated by highways and parking lots, just like this. And until we change that, traffic will continue to exist. But it's not just the traffic we should be concerned about. It's also the ridiculous cost of building and maintaining this car-dependent landscape, and what we could do with that money instead. For example, this particular interchange in Sarasota cost $74.5 million to build. When you consider the materials, labor, and land required for just 1 mile of roadway, which is often in the millions of dollars alone, then factor in the ongoing maintenance, repaving, and repairing damage, costs become astronomical, almost always at the taxpayer expense. These costs aren't just one-time expenses either. They happen year after year, often consuming a huge portion of city budgets. And with each new road or expansion project, these expenses only grow, placing an ever-increasing strain on public funds. Which leads to an important question. Could these resources be used more effectively to develop better infrastructure? Now, let me clarify, road safety projects are incredibly important, especially in places where people have no other options. There's a lot of bad road design out there, and projects like Diverging Diamonds will inevitably save lives. But we can question the scale of some of these projects and imagine if a portion of the funds spent on roads and highways were diverted into improving public transit, building bike lanes, and creating pedestrian-friendly zones. If the Diverging Diamond in Sarasota had two fewer lanes, for example, how much could we have improved walking and cycling in the area with the money instead? These are the questions we need to ask as citizens, politicians, engineers, and city planners. The potential transformation in how we get around and quality of life could be profound. Will we continue building for the car, or will we start building for people? It might seem too far gone at this point, but I believe we can build good suburbs. We just have to change a few important things, which I go into depth in this next video you can watch here. And if you liked this video, be sure to subscribe as I'll have more videos about suburbs, traffic engineering, and urban planning in the future.